Hello, my name is Fulton Colburn. I am the curator at the Nora Eccles Harrison Museum of Art here in Logan, Utah at Utah State University. It's March 9th, 2022. And with me here today is collector, donor, scholar, et cetera, George R. Wallace. And he's accepted our invitation to speak about a collection that we have up of work that he owns on early Utah artists. And it's in an exhibition celebrating the 40th anniversary of the Nora Eccles Harrison Museum of Art. And the show is titled Looking Backward and Forward, 40 Years with NEMA and What's Next. And the show is going to be up through December 17th, 2022. So there's lots of time to come and see it. And the component of the exhibition that Mr. Wanless lent to is for looking forward. And ironically enough, we're actually dealing with early Utah artists, which in a way is looking backwards, but he's lent us work by 20 different early Utah artists. And I'm gonna jump right into it. How did you first get interested in collecting early Utah artists, and why do you think it's important, George?
My initial acquaintance with Utah artists came from my own household growing up as a boy, and also from my grandmother's house. Each of them had painting by a man named Henry Moser. And in my grandmother's case, she had a close and friendly relationship with him over many years. Having only one significant work of art in one's household focuses your attention. And I always quite liked the painting of the Tetons that we had in our house in Cincinnati, Ohio. It's a good painting, and it's a very important piece of Henry Moser's work. So I've always been interested in him, and I got started as a collector as a result of that interest. I went to a junk shop in Hiram, Utah. I had a dairy in Paradise, Utah. And I went to a junk shop, and there was a very small painting of Bear Lake in the junk shop there. And I bought it for $7.50. And as I bought it and checked out, the lady said, oh, you're buying it for the frame. And I nodded assent and went on out with my prize purchase. One of the things that Moser did that made him especially interesting to me was he portrayed local scenes. The picture that we had at home was a picture of the Tetons and Jenny's Lake, which is one of the great beauty spots of the American West. And the painting that I bought, the little small painting, oil painting, was of Bear Lake, which is, again, one of the great beauty spots of the American West. So it was that which originally drew me to Utah artists. They drew the landscapes that I was familiar with and loved. After that, I started I've always been an inveterate collector. I've collected all kinds of things as a boy, and I started making a collection of art that was painted by Utah artists. And I found that at that particular moment in time, and we're talking about the 70s in Utah, a lot of art was coming on the market. And these things happen in the collector's experience and history. You suddenly find the market is flooded with certain things. The flood lasts a few years and then it dissipates. One of the occasions for this particular flood was the fact that there were a handful of artists returning from other parts of the world to their homes in Utah. One of these was Waldo Midgley, who was connected to Mohan Rai Young. And I bought some things from Waldo and had the pleasure of meeting him shortly before he passed on. Also, the other thing I think that's important in collecting is my family's connection to Mohan Rai Young. My grandmother, Maria Eccles Kane, had actually studied in Chicago at the Art Institute and also at the Art Students League in New York. And she studied there with Mohan Rai Young and Gifford and Reynolds Beale. So it was only natural that I, and also, of course, Mohenrai Young was, his sculpture was a great interest to me. So I got interested in collecting, I became interested in collecting Mohenrai Young. One of the first pieces I bought for the museum collection was The Right to the Jaw, which is, I think, one of the, perhaps the greatest of the Mohenrai Young bronze boxing sculptures. And after that, my interests broadened out, and on weekends when I could find time away from the dairy, I traveled to Salt Lake City and visited some of the local galleries that were selling art. And I bought more pieces, mostly drawings by Mohenrai Young, but one bronze connected to the Ashcan School in New York, which he worked closely with. And also pieces by other Utah artists. I also learned that Logan had a very intimate history with several of these artists. Henry Moser, for instance, taught in Logan at the, what was then the Utah State Agricultural College. And another man, A.B. Wright, also taught there. One of the things that I think is important is the connection of Logan and Logan artists to the development of modernism in the art history of the state of Utah. In 1889, J.T. Harwood was sent to Paris to study art by the Mormon Church. We're not supposed to say Mormon anymore, so it should be the Latter-day Church of the Latter-day Saints. Anyway, this is true of almost all of the artists that worked in Utah early on in the 20th century. So for instance, A.B. Wright, he was sent to Paris and studied there. Henry Moser went to Paris and studied and became, actually was acquainted with several of the Fauvist artists and also with Picasso, he claims. So they had an experience in which they were exposed to what was going on, and they brought some of that knowledge back to Utah with them and changed what was going on very early in the 20th century. Later on, we can talk a little bit about what happened in Logan later on, after Utah State Agricultural College established an art department. It's important to remember how small that was. Really, at first, there were only two artists in the department. There was H. Reuben Reynolds and there was Calvin Fletcher. And around the, somewhere in the late 20s, they decided that they didn't have enough exposure to modernism. They knew things were happening in America, and the different trends had appeared and artists were doing different things, but they weren't as well aware as they felt they should have been as to what was happening. So they imported artists for summer studies, and this brought a great change, not only in their art, but also in the art of other Utah artists. And it was an influx of modernist influences. Artists they brought in, B.J. O. Nordfeld, for instance, Ralph Stackpole, Birger Sanzin, they all came and made some great differences. One of the interesting ramifications of the difference was the development, sudden appearance and development of the mural tradition in Utah. If you go to some of the meeting houses in Logan now, and it used to be that I think you still can go to the Bluebird and see a mural there. In the 30s, Ralph Stackpole came to Logan fresh from his experience in San Francisco painting murals and working on the murals with Diego Rivera. And actually in the early 30s, there was an exhibition of work by Diego Rivera in Logan, Utah. So these murals that have suddenly appeared really came from the Mexican muralist tradition, which is, I think, a good example of the ways in which modernism was brought to penetrate and permeate the Utah artistic scene.
So where do you think Utah fits in with the rest of the West in terms of their early development artistically? Do you think that this patronage of the church really helped to spur on the cosmopolitan ideas here, especially given the art scene relative to Arizona, Idaho, Wyoming, California?
I think the church sent artists to Paris, not really realizing that these artists were going to be exposed to modern, early modernist tendencies in Europe. They were sent to study in these academies, which were very traditional teaching institutions. So you were exposed to classical plaster sculpture. And then if you graduated from that successfully, you moved on to live models. And I think a lot of the acquaintance that the Utah artists had with so-called modernist trends in Paris, France, came about as a result of their acquaintance with the artists that were working there and the art that was exposed in various shows. I don't think the church had that in mind at the time. I think they wanted the church authorities. I think they wanted mural decorations in the temples, and that's why the artists were sent there to study, so they would become proficient artists.
So
you also asked a question about Utah's place in the West. I think Utah has always been sort of trying to catch up, and I'm not sure we've even arrived there yet, although we're making efforts in that direction. There's little in the way of an art market in Utah, and I think a lot of the young men that showed great talent moved on to other locations to study and stayed away, and it's rather sad, but I'm hoping that with the museum in Logan, which was once called the Athens of Utah, for instance, I hope that this comes back to life. I hope we have a burgeoning artistic community in Utah, and that it thrives and grows and becomes more contemporary than it has been in the past.
So that's it's an interesting notion that the church was supporting the efforts of these artists to get trained in Europe, as it turns out, in the most avant-garde schools that there was at the time. And yet they weren't intending for those artists to be exposed to some of those radical ideas that were being talked about, discussed, and going about in the culture at the time in Paris. So when those artists came back to Utah, do you think they were stifled by the church in terms of their art making production to some degree, or do you think they really needed to knuckle down and do things that were going to be okay with the church instead of expanding and trying out some of the theories and ideas that they had learned in Paris?
I think both things happened. I think with some of the artists that came back, let's take the example of Henry Moser, for instance. One of the problems the Utah artists had was assimilating something as radical, making a rapid assimilation of something that they didn't really understand very well. So Moser was exposed to a new palette in the artists that he encountered, the work of the artists he encountered in Paris. And he brought their ideas about this palette back to Utah, but he didn't translate that into a radical depiction of landscape. His landscapes are very traditional, but with the introduction of this palette. And then over the years, that influence sort of waned and wore off, and the work he did became less and less radical. Some of the other artists, I think, that traveled or studied in Europe had a hard time too assimilating. I know, for instance, when B.J. L. Nordfeldt taught in Logan, he too had been exposed to the Cubists in France, and he brought some of these ideas back to Logan, but the his understanding of Cubism was pretty shallow. And what little he had learned from the Cubists, he brought it to Logan with him and he tried to teach it, but it achieved some changes, but they were not Cubism as we think of it in our French context. So I think the problem is these ideas, even though we look at them and we think, oh, then we understand Cézanne, for instance. Well, it's much more difficult to understand, especially for people that aren't artists, but the artists themselves had a hard time understanding this material. And I think there were artists like LeConte Stewart that also believed in going their own way. and he did. one of the artists that I loaned a piece by, there's the Kalmar painting of a glacier in Alaska. I think it's also interesting that artists chose to study in New York, a Utah artist chose to study in New York and in Chicago. They were smart about where they went to learn, in that they went to the centers of teaching in America as well. Kalmar actually studied with Frederick Church, and you can, in this painting, you can see the influence of Church on his own work. So,
great. That's about sums. You actually answered most of the questions I had just by talking about art in Utah. I'm just wondering what relationship you see between the art that was going on in Salt Lake City and what was happening here in Logan. I know that art was developing earlier in Salt Lake City as a center, and it was only until you mentioned until the 20s when things started to take off here in Logan. Do you think it's like a two-point trajectory, that is, that, you know, artists were studying Impressionism originally in Paris and then coming back and practicing that in Salt Lake, and then later in the 20s and 30s, some of the more adventuresome artists were teaching here at USU in Cache Valley and living in Cache Valley as opposed to Salt Lake City?
I think we should remember that some of these artists that visited France were actually teaching in Logan as early as 19. I think I found out that Moser was, he was in Paris in 1908 and came back to Logan. A.B. Wright taught in Logan, Utah early on. He taught in Logan 1904. After having returned from France. I had to do a little study to come up with some of these things, but it was interesting to me that these influences had already come back to Logan early on. When you talk about Salt Lake City being a center of a modernist art, I guess I have a problem with that. The only artists that I can think of that, of importance. Well, there were several of importance, but the one that I think of first is J.T. Harwood, because he was the first to go to Paris, and he was a very highly skilled artist. But I never felt that other than he came back with some ideas about pointillism, but there again, you have an artist that didn't really understand pointillism, even though he introduced some aspects of it into his painting. So I, as far as a modernist painter, I guess he's the only one I can think of early in the 20th century in Salt Lake. There may have been others, but I think we sort of forget how important Logan was very early on. And it's one of the things that's kind of surprising to me, because it doesn't seem to be the artistic center of Utah anymore, that's for sure. Other than at the museum, Bolton, thank you.
Well, thank you, George. I don't know if there's anything else you wanted to add to this.
I'd just like to mention something about the Irene Fletcher painting that's up. Oh. One of the things that we've forgotten about Irene Fletcher is not just how skilled she was, but also she's another good example of the ways in which Logan artists have sought to continue their education. One of the things, and just looking over, researching some of the artists in my collection for purposes of this little talk, I was amazed by how much effort there was on the part of artists like, for instance, Harry Reynolds. And Irene went back and studied with Grant Wood. And I think you see that influence very clearly in this self-portrait. But they traveled in the United States. They went abroad. Reynolds went abroad and searched out various, he was interested in gardens, for instance, and photography and art. So it's illustrative, I believe, of the effort of Logan artists to continue their education. And it went on and on. So we should be proud of them and glad that they were there to teach they've given us a chance to enjoy the work they created. And the opportunity to collect it, Bolton.
Yes. Yes, absolutely. Well, thank you, George. I appreciate your time and willingness to talk with me about the subject. So.
Thank you for the opportunity, Bolton, and good luck at the museum.
Thank you.